Hello everyone, and welcome to the lecture one of Java programming class. So before we start coding in Java in this class, first we're going to talk about some computer basics, such as some of the basic concepts, software and program, virtual machine, programming languages, and object-oriented programming and its relationship with Java. And then in our second part of lecture, we're going to talk about how we can set up our computer to write Java codes and also start writing some simple Java programs. So let's get started. So first, let's see some basic parts of computer. All computers consist of a set of components that work together to form the computer as a whole. So a central processing unit, CPU for short, a memory, and input-output devices. So now here's a graphic illustration to show the relationship between them. So every computer receives input either from mouse, keyboard, or any other input device and processes the input, working with the memory to store data. And then finally, output. The process data to information either on the user screen, printer, or save to a file. So this is a highly overview of computer parts. So what is a central processing unit in a little bit more detail? And as you can see a picture of an old processor. So CPU provides the primary computational capabilities of the computer. All CPUs are designed to understand a specific instruction set. Instruction sets define various types of operations such as basic arithmetic operations, load data from and store to memory, make logical comparisons, and alter program flow. So CPUs contain a limited number of registers that provide fast, short-term storage for data when needed. So the instructions that CPU executes are called machine instructions, performs very small operations such as move a value to from one register to another, move a value from a register to memory, compare the content of two registers. As you can see, they're very, very simple and detailed steps. Machine instructions are not in a form that can be easily read and understood by a person. So assembly language is a little bit higher level of machine language, is a human readable form that uses mnemonic representations of the instructions. There's a one-to-one relationship between a machine instruction and assembly language code. In general, the instructions designed for one type of CPUs can't normally be used for another type. So Intel CPU family, for example, is one type of family. Okay, so there's some families of CPU which can maintain backward compatibility. So Intel and AMD are part of the same CPU family. Right, so let's talk about memory. The memory of the computer is used to store both instructions in the form of machine code and data. The memory is primarily intended to hold information only during the execution of program, so it's temporary. Memory in a computer is addressable. CPUs can access a specific location in memory given its address at any time. That's why we call it RAM, which is short for random access memory. And instructions are obtained from sequential locations in the memory. Some instructions can alter the flow by causing execution to jump to a different location. And finally, let's talk about input and output. So I/O, short for input and output, I/O devices include keyboard, monitor, mouse, touchscreen, video input, and sound input. I/O devices enable humans to interact with the computer. And in some cases, the computers use I/O to communicate with another device, such as a storage device, a network device, a robotic control interface. So NIC, short for network interface card, is also an input and output device that allows you to communicate with other computers. Right, so next we're going to talk about very briefly about operating systems. OS, again, is short for operating systems, is the master program that controls computer. OS manages the hardware components of the computer. OS serves two primary functions. One, provides a base level of functionality that other programs need, and then controls the execution of other programs. Some of the operating systems are the ones for desktop are Windows, Unix, Linux, and Mac. And then the famous for ones for mobile devices are iOS, Android, and BlackBerry. And then here's a graphic illustration of where operating system sits in a computer configuration. So it sits on the top of hardware, which means it controls the hardware. Also, it controls the applications and provides a communication between the applications and the actual hardware that executes the application. Alright, so bits and bytes. At the lowest level, computers actually work on ones and zeros. As a result, a number system based on one and zero is needed, which is called binary number system. A binary number system is, in binary, a bit is a binary digit, which could be 0 or 1. A byte is typically or always 8 bits, and that's the smallest piece of information. All programs and data are stored in the computer as a sequence of bits. Again, 1 byte at a time. So another important number system that will be important will be hexadecimal, which is a base 16 number system, which means it does have 16 digits, the ones including from 0 to 9, plus A, B, C, D, and F. So here's an example. So this number sequence, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, is a binary number, which is equal to the decimal 65, which we are used to, which also equal to hexadecimal 41, and that also corresponds to the letter A. So if anytime you type capital letter A in the keyboard, you actually pass this number sequence. So and then here's a widget that can count from 0 to 31, which are all the numbers you can represent in a 5-bit number sequence. Right. So finally, we're not gonna talk any more detail about binary systems and hexadecimal systems, but you should definitely click on this link and watch the number system from Khan Academy, both to understand how these number systems work and how the conversions work between them. Also to be able to complete lab one. Right, so move on, the program. A program consists of a sequence of instructions that can be executed by a computer. A program can have two basic forms, human readable, which is also called source code, and generally is an ASCII text file, just like a regular Word file, and it's not executable by the computer. So it's a regular text file that can be opened by any text editor and is human readable, but is not executable by the computer. So on the other hand, machine readable is an object code, in other words, or bytecode for in the case of Java, is a machine executable. So machines do understand object code and is nearly impossible for humans to read or understand. So the relationship between them, we generally write human readable code, and a compiler converts this human readable code into object code or machine code, in other words. All right. So virtual machine is another important concept. So in some cases, the instructions in the object file are not designed for an actual physical CPU. Instead, they are designed to be executed by a virtual machine, which is a software that emulates a CPU. So a VM has its own instruction set, just like it behaves like a CPU, but is an actually a software-based CPU. So interpreting is the term to use to describe executing this virtual machine instructions. Okay, so moving on to program languages, there are usually two type of program languages we just saw earlier. Low level language are closer to the hardware, machine language, object code. Assembly language is also a low level computer language, and there's a one-to-one correspondence between each assembly code and a machine instruction. Again, the difference between assembly and machine instruction is assembly is human readable, although still difficult to code in assembly language, but it is understandable and doable. So high level languages are easy for humans to read and write, such as Java, and they use keywords, operators, and punctuations. C, C++, Python, Java are just some of the examples. And compilers are programs that translate a high-level language into object code. So we can write high-level languages, but we have to compile them into a low-level machine code. So here's a word cloud that shows some of the most commonly used programming languages in the world. So next, we're going to talk about object-oriented programming. The code in object-oriented programming, the code is organized around the data. You define the data and the routines that are permitted to act on the data. A class is an important term in an object-oriented programming. A class encapsulates the data and routines acting on the data. And a class is actually a template for an object. And an object is an instance of a class. So a class is more like a blueprint. An object is an actual physical instance. So here's an example of object hierarchy. So vehicle can be an object. So it's car, truck, patrol can be another object. And electric, which can also be another object. Okay, so let's move on. There are three main concepts of object-oriented programming, which are encapsulation, polymorphism, and inheritance. So also there's an abstraction is an important concept for every program language, not necessarily object-oriented programming. So let's talk about Java now. Java is a high-level language conceived by James Gosling in 1991. It was named Java. It was renamed to Java in 1995. And Java is an object-oriented programming. Its syntax is similar to the older languages such as C and C++. It is an important language for the internet and mobile devices. So where is Java used in general? Mobile applications. Such as the ones in Android devices, desktop applications, web applications, web servers, usually back-end server applications, and games is also another way which Java could be used. Okay, so why do we want to learn Java? Just a little bit of motivate yourself. Java, one of the important features of Java is that Java works on different platforms the exact same way. So you can write once and run anywhere. So Windows, Mac, Linux, Raspberry, they can all be you work with same Java bytecode. It's easy to learn and it's simple to use. is open source and free, at least for now. And it's secure, fast, and very, very powerful. It has a huge community support, so which could tens of millions of developers. It also means that thousands of libraries already available for us to use. And the most importantly, it is the one of most popular programming language in the world. So here's the data here that shows the top 20 most popular programming languages as of February 2019. Java sits on number one, C, Python, C++. So in any way you look at it, Java is always in the top three chart. So it's also, if you want to read this data here, click on the link. You will also that Java is highly sought after skill in job market. All right, so let's talk about Java Virtual Machine. So Java compilers do not generate machine code for a CPU. Java compilers generate machine code for JVM, which is Java Virtual Machine. The JVM machine code, also called bytecode, is executed by Java Virtual Machine interpreter program on each computer, also known as Java runtime environment. So every computer in the world most likely have Java installed already. So Java program files that are Java source files have .java extensions, again, which it is a text file, can be opened by any text editor. And Java bytecode files have .class extension, which are the executable Java code. Okay, so lastly, we're going to talk about command line, and I'll let you know why knowing command line is important. So command line interface is a command line program that accepts text input to execute operating system functions. The little bit of background of command line in the 60s, using only computer terminals, this was the only way to interact with a computer. So however, in 70s, 80s, command line input was commonly used by Unix systems and a PC systems such as MS-DOS or Apple DOS. And today, with graphical user interface, most users never use command line interfaces. However, command line interface is still used by software developers and system administrators to configure programs, install software, and access features that are not available in the graphical user interface. So why this is important for us is because we will use command line to compile and execute Java program. So we better learn it. Right. So in Mac, we have a terminal, which is the Mac's command line interface, also for Linux. This is how it looks. And in Windows, we have command prompt, which looks like this. So most cases, their users are very similar to each other. So how do we open them? To open terminal in Mac, you can search for terminal in the spotlight. And then you can click on the find the terminal and then click on it. And in Windows, you should open the start menu and type cmd in the search bar and then click on the command prompt app to proceed to open the command line. So and next, here are some of the important commands that we need to know for this class. As you can see, between Mac and Windows, they're usually the same, except with some differences. Ls is a Mac command. Dir is a Windows command. It's one of the most used command. Is to list the directory system, which is it will list every folder and file in a directory. Cd space path name is for to change directory, moving from one directory to another. And then cd space dot dot is to move one level up, which also means that exit out of a folder or a directory. Okay, so there's some others are here. You can pause the video here, or you can use the presentation slides to take a look at them.